started in this industry in sport content, some of you have been a few years, some a little bit longer. Can you just talk about what sport content looked like when you started in the industry? So just tell me who you are, how long you've been doing it, and kind of what sport content looked like when you started, and we're going to kind of work ourselves forward to the future of sport content. So you can go ahead right here.
I'm Rick Camp. I'm a producer at 670 The Score. Normally right now I'm on the board for Spiegel & Parkins. So I do that. I do updates a little bit as well and host on weekends and a couple times at nights. Do some work, written a couple times for the website as well. Just trying to think. I got hired at The Score at the end of 2011, full-time beginning of 2016. So I'm trying to think, even just like when I first started, even just thinking about the Twitter world and what that was like, because for me, and a lot of times in sports, Twitter reigns supreme, for better or for worse. That's just kind of what it is. And so much more video now, so much more in terms of clickbait, I guess, is what you want to look at. You have to do more diligence on your own part in terms of the content that's put out there, what's true, what's not, in terms of who's saying what, why they're saying it specifically, and a lot more behind the scenes, I think, now than there was even back then. And it's a lot of what I know these guys specialize in, is getting that content, learning who everybody is, as opposed to more traditional mediums like myself in radio or your traditional TV aspects. So it's probably where it's grown the most, is just what it actually is and how much work you as a consumer have to do to figure out what's true and what's not.
Right.
Afternoon, everybody. Let me start by saying this is an awesome event, so pat yourselves on the back for all you guys wearing the red lanyards. This is really impressive, and you guys did a great job. Jason said, my name's Ray O'Connell. I work over in communications at Northwestern. Been in that role for about 2 years now. Before that, I worked in football operations at Northwestern, and I guess I'm getting kind of older, because the way I started with social media and getting into content creation and stuff, I was actually a football recruiting volunteer in 2012, and Northwestern football didn't have a Twitter account, so I just started the Twitter account and kind of fell in love with it and went from there. And obviously, just looking back on it and thinking about this topic, that was only 6 years ago. And just the evolution of, you know, Rick kind of touched on it, social media and intertwining it with traditional media. And it's just gotten to this complex state that is ever evolving, and we need to evolve with it. So that's it.
Yeah, that's good. Kamil?
You guys hear me? Hello? Oh, no.
Hello? Was it mine or yours?
Hello?
Yeah, it's ours.
It's here.
All right, cool. All right. My name is Kamil Strycharz. I'm a digital content coordinator with Chicago Bulls. And basically, this role is two jobs in one, kind of. The first one is to monetize our digital assets. So what that means is making sure we make money from our social media channels, our website, and mobile app. And the second job is a little bit more sexy. It's the game day coverage. So whether that be tweeting the game or cutting up highlights, creating graphics, that kind of stuff. I've only been working here for, not here, but with the Bulls for a year, so nothing much has really changed within, I guess, the industry besides the constantly changing algorithms and kind of updates that go on, like with Snapchat, for example. So.
Jordan.
Yeah, my name is Jordan. I'm the social media coordinator for the
Jordan hit on the head by saying there's not just like one specific thing you're doing, there's a ton of little things you're doing as well. Just to give a quick background, graduated last year from DePaul University, double majored in marketing, honors, and finance, so I guess I had a broad range of skills, but if you want to get into the sports industry, let's say if you want to get into social media, again, it's not just be an expert at tweeting, it's not a thing. You have the experience with Photoshop or Adobe Premiere, it's all these little skills to add on, and more that you have, the more marketable you are as a employee.
Go right. Yeah, so I always knew I wanted to work in sports. I did my undergrad at Marquette. My man back here wearing his Marquette polo. And while I was there, I worked in media relations and sports information. And Jason, as you know, working in college athletics, that role of a sports information director has totally changed. We like to joke and call it, we're PR practitioners. I took one graphic design class in college. I said, I will never use this. I got a C. Now I use it every day, probably 4 hours a day. I had to reteach myself. I had to watch YouTube videos. So, you never know what kind of tools you're gonna need. And like I said, it's always evolving. And so be open to that. Be open to putting your hand into video and just starting out. Even if it's basic, just introducing yourself to those tools, because this industry is going to change. In my role specifically in communications, we at Northwestern, we're a little bit of a smaller staff, so I get to wear a lot of hats, and I see that as a benefit. So I do all the graphics for our men's basketball program. I do the tweeting for our men's basketball program, but I also am helping with media relations, so getting Chris Collins on 670 Score, working with the Chicago Tribune. So I get to wear all these different hats, and So I guess just being open to experiencing as many different roles as you can, and that just makes you more valuable when you're trying to sell yourself getting into this industry.
Yeah, and I guess mine's a little different, not being in just a kind of a different side of it. Instead of purely digital side, which really I guess all media is kind of blending together in the way that everybody consumes it, being on the radio side, which is kind of almost archaic at this point to talk about, but it's the basic skills for whatever your individual position is the jump street of it. For me, it's being able to edit audio, understanding what's important, what's the news of the day. Above all else, outside of functionally being able to run an audio board and use editing software, I know for a fact that my program director, my boss, values understanding of what's the hits. It's always, what are the hits? What are the big topics of the day? Because if I produce a really well done thing about something that's not relevant for the day, that's never going to get played, then what did I just do for the last hour? I just wasted my time. So that, and the thing that I lament the most is when I was a student at the Illinois Media School when I finally decided on what I wanted to do, and I pretty much did what I had to get through all my video stuff. Retained basically none of it. I couldn't white balance a camera right now if I was asked to or anything. And I lament that every single day because we have video streams for our shows. I could do more with my personal social media to build my individual brand, which then helps my show brand, which then helps the station brand, hopefully. So that's the kind of stuff that you have to hope you can do. And also just in my job, on days where maybe I'm the person that has to go down and when we have an in-person guest, get them situated, book those people. Being able to just be, it was said in the last panel, basically, the ability to not be a jerk and do your job well and be someone that people are willing to make sacrifices for, if they're time to come on for an interview or in terms of time to come in studio as opposed to do an interview on the phone, those are things that make you more valuable in my specific job that are all kind of woven into, I know, what my program director looks for when he's hiring new people.
You each mentioned Twitter in your first opening one. So one of my questions is, is Twitter top platform, in your guys' mind? Obviously, I know there are many other platforms out there, but I thought that was interesting that each of you mentioned tweeting or Twitter. Just talk about the different platforms that you use and how do you utilize them differently. Kamil, you can start with this one.
Awesome. For Twitter, for example, I guess for every platform, there's a different audience, obviously. So for example, Snapchat, it's usually geared towards the younger audience. And then Facebook is quickly becoming more so for the Discord, people get Twitter, it's actually a news platform. It's no longer a social media network. And so we treat it a lot more so as a news outlet. So this can be from any kind of like new trade deals, any kind of PR announcements that we have, and any kind of live updates to the game, like there's highlights, anything like that. So we treat Twitter more so as a news aggregator slash outlet. On Facebook, do you want me to go to each platform? Because I can do it.
You can go over it, and then obviously everybody else pay attention, and we'll try to, you know, take out different pieces.
Okay, cool.
Else.
Facebook, it's a lot more geared towards video. Right now, there's a recent algorithm change where it's pushing more towards news. They're combating fake news a lot, so they are pushing heavily towards news. We're going to be pushing a lot more articles on there, and then obviously video. For Instagram, obviously pictures and photos work amazing there, so it's, I guess, self-explanatory. Snapchat, a lot more focused towards behind the scenes. It's places where it's not, well, now you can upload on there, but it's more natural to show behind the scenes. Like recently we had Snapchat takeovers from, like for example, myself, we've had from different departments take over the Snapchat account, show the different side of the Bulls. And then website app.
I mean, Kamil kind of hit on a lot of the general, and we kind of operate the same way too. But for us specifically at Northwestern and Northwestern Athletics, it's focusing internal on our brand, right? Like we brand ourselves Chicago's Big Ten team, even though some people don't like to think so. We are.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Okay. But we do, and we fight a stigma, right? Like here's this white collar school on the North Shore of Chicago with world class academics, and that's just that surface level, right? So, but in actuality, we have some of the most well rounded student athletes that are genuinely cool people and interesting people, interesting stories to tell. So we kind of our strategy, we kind of combat that. that white collar stuffy institution and turn our focus to how we can share the personalities of our student athletes, our coaches, and show that they're kind of just like the rest of us, right? They're just, I guess I'm kind of getting away from your question.
That's
a little
okay.
bit,
but it's good information.
Yes. So how we do that, we kind of think, Twitter and Instagram first with everything we do, and we talked a lot about video, right? So we're gonna make our videos no longer than 3 minutes, right? And for certain things on game days, right, we're gonna have a game day video. Instead of doing just a graphic, we're gonna have a graphic, and that graphic's gonna be served specifically to Twitter. We're gonna have a 30-second game day video to try to build some hype and some awareness, and that's gonna primarily serve our Facebook and a little bit of Instagram, and obviously there's gonna be cross-platform sharing with all that stuff, but we that's how we kind of approach each. There's a reason behind everything we do, right? We're not just creating a video and be like, all right, share on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. There's a reason why we do each, and tapping into these algorithms and paying attention to that stuff can only help our brand and what we're trying to accomplish.
And Rick, from your end on the radio side?
Yeah, for us, we use Twitter the most by a mile. At least individually on our show. We use it for whatever's coming up next. Hey, next we're gonna talk to Pat Fitzgerald and we're gonna have a conversation, but really just wait for him to squeeze in and go Cats at the end of it.
That's right.
Like, you know, that's the kind of, he did that when we had our, he gave a Super Bowl prediction and we died from it. So that was actually a really good one. Then it'll be, or we're talking about this topic next, give us a call 312-644-6767. Text us at 6711. Or the Twitter feedback. A lot of times we're looking for feedback on Twitter in and of itself. Facebook, we have for the midday and afternoon shows, there's a live stream going for that. Just on Facebook, there's a separate chat going on Facebook Live for that. But it's more the long form stuff that we'll put on Facebook. And in terms of use of Instagram, Snapchat for us, at least individually, it's much more about following the athletes than anything else. Excuse me, so just keeping up with what they're doing, anything that could turn into news, and that's about it.
Jordan, for you, just touch on the metrics and the algorithms and things like that. I didn't touch on that, so kind
yeah.
of tying that together.
So we look at Twitter engagement per fan, so we're always trying to see what is performing the best, knowing that people are only viewing videos for at most 6 seconds. So just
things I would say too is that I found interesting is the actual platform and the people that work at Facebook and Twitter and I guess Instagram and Facebook, but those are resources for us, right? Like we weren't verified on Instagram last year, and we made this run to our first NCAA tournament, and all we did was simply reach out to Instagram and said, hey, can you verify us? And they're like, no, yeah, for sure. Like, yeah, we can make that happen. And we just saw our following explode just from that. And using those folks at those places and resources has been extremely valuable, especially with all the changes that are going on, tapping into them and seeing what's come down the pike.
Absolutely. Let's talk about content ownership. There's been a lot of changes with that in recent years. Who wants to take that one?
I'll take it.
Neil, go ahead.
Mine.
All right.
We're kind of lucky, I guess all of us are, where the product, well, I guess more so of us right here, the product is actually, let's say for example, someone steals a Bulls video, right? The product is there, the players are in that video, so it's kind of good that they are stealing it, but then again, it's bad because we're not getting those views, we're not getting those. If they're, so for an example, I'm sorry, I'm going kind of on a tangent.
Sorry.
On your iPhone, like the newest update allows you to screen record, and so you see that a lot of fan accounts, a lot of these pages are stealing our content and putting it onto theirs. So this is really bad for when it comes to any kind of sponsorship things that we have. So for example, we do a Budweiser animation series, and there's fan pages that are recording the content and then stealing it. So then when we report back to Budweiser, who we're doing that animation series for, we say, oh, we only got this many views while this fan account kind of stole our reach, you know? So when it comes to ownership of content, it's good that it's so easy to distribute the content, but it is bad when it comes to reporting back to partners or, you know, delivering back to your higher ups saying like, hey, our reach went down, but this is out more. So.
Yeah, ours is a little bit different. MLB has, it's a company called MLB Advanced Media, so our digital rights, 50% are owned by BAM. So anything that we're making, part of that proceed goes to BAM, so we don't own everything, so it's kind of a little bit of a struggle, but we work with it.
College side there, right?
Well, so the college side is interesting. I think one of the things too, and I don't know how closely you guys follow some of this, but like licensed music is big right now, and we saw that on National Signing Day, right? Like when all these hype videos and sweet videos that these athletic departments and franchises can and create are way better when you can put popular music and, you know, when the White Sox or Bulls can use the Chance the Rapper song and touch into that, tap into that, like, that home Chicago feel, like, that's awesome. We can't do that because we get sued. and so we have to use this site called APM for our music. And Well, it's fine, and there's a great variety of music. You know, it's not something that, you know, the consumer is familiar with, that they know, and it maybe takes away from it a little bit. But the incident I'm referencing on National Signing Day, which is a big day for digital media, some institutions got busted for using licensed music, and their Twitters got taken down.
Texas,
Mizzou. Georgia. I mean, these are national brands, and they got busted. And I'm not gonna lie, I did a little fist bump because I was like, we've been playing on non-equal levels. So that's been interesting. I think for us on the college level too, especially being Northwestern in the Big Ten, in-game highlights. Like, I'm so jealous of the MLB and some of the NBA, like that they can just cut and put out. For us, in-game. You know, we have a great partnership with the Big Ten Network, but for our revenue sports like football and men's basketball, we're very limited on clipping in-game highlights, right? So we have to rely on Big Ten Network to do it for us, or we have to go retweet ESPN if one of our players has a big dunk. So that's a little difficult, but, you know, then it comes back to us as content creators of how can we work around that, right? And how can we create maybe an animated GIF or some type of graphic in-game that will allow us to illustrate that, yeah.
And then Rick, for you, you know, being a media outlet that covers all of these teams, how do you handle the content?
especially because so much of us as individuals, when we're not, like, while the games are going on, when we're not on the air, it is so Twitter-centric. And it's a conversation I've had with multiple bosses and other people at work of just, yeah, when to just retweet versus actually, like, quote the tweet or just reply and put your comment on there as well. But, and, you know, I don't think there's actually a consensus really with us, which a lot of what I like, and which I guess can also to some view as flawed, is that each individual in each show, maybe there's a show philosophy versus another. Each show and each person can be so different. Now, there's obviously, you don't cross any lines, but, you know, when it comes to how you treat your own personal individual Twitter account or a show account or whatever, that's kind of on each individual person. But the licensed music made me think of something, too. We used to be able to, when we podcast our shows, we just cut out commercials and be good. However, now we're fine on the air, but in terms of when we're putting the podcast or the show up, we had to create a whole separate feed that logs the show that does not have anything that, like, any of the commercials or any of the music come through it, where on the computer that we play all that through, specifically because of that. So we just go from content, okay, we'll be back on 670 The Score, to then the beginning of the next segment with no music at all in the middle. Now, there are times for our show content that sounds great. When someone's singing with a song, and then I can go back in that other feed and not have the song with it, just have the person's individual lyrics, that's great, because when they sing terribly, we can bring that back on the air. But, you know, it's just kind of working around some of the constraints that we have. But especially with, like, highlights or whatever, most of the time it's either a retweet or just a quick quote or something like that. But in terms of, we don't really put out a ton of individual video content to where anything would be that, it's not the most relevant thing, I guess, specifically for us, when we're just reacting to what everybody else is already putting out there.
All right, next one I'll go to is success of your content. So the first thing I want you to talk about is one campaign or one item of content that you were involved with that was the most successful piece or one of the most successful pieces, and then how you judge or deem something to be successful. So you want to start with that one, right?
Yeah, I've got two that are both incredibly dumb and ridiculous, but they worked. One thing I did individually is, so when a couple years ago, when we always broadcast at the auto show, the Score broadcast at the auto show as a part-time producer, I was out there working with the Boards and Bernstein show. So during breaks, during the show, whenever I would see anybody that looked kind of odd, I guess by now standards, be a jerk, and take pictures of odd-looking people and post them with the hashtag auto show people. And there were just some of them that got a bunch of retweets, bunch of likes, and even, like, mentions on the air. And for me individually, it was a great day because the couple mentions on air got me, you know, a few hundred new followers in a given day. And then also a thing that I do now that was born in the Spiegel and Parkin show, the show I work on every day, called the I'm Fat Podcast. The guy I work with and myself are not the most svelte people in the world. You could just look at the rest of this panel and I kind of stick out. But, you know, we've had a bit on the air of whenever there's food things, well, let's ask the I'm Fat Podcast over there. And it was just a bit on the show. We never didn't do one for months. And then we finally did one right before Thanksgiving. We did another one a few weeks ago, and we do good numbers on it, even with the limited reach that that our awesome website has. So that's, I guess, for as far as I can go. That's
right. I'm gonna guess yours are a little different than that.
Yeah, I'm gonna start following it. It's weird. Let's see. We actually had we did a couple campaigns last year with our football and men's basketball programs. And in the past, we had moved away from focusing on the student athletes and promoting them because of this. You know, there's obviously a sensitivity of student athletes and they're not paid, but they bring money, and that's a whole different issue. But we branded one of our best football players, Anthony Walker Jr., who now plays with the Indianapolis Colts. His teammates jokingly called him the franchise, right? So we kind of ran with that idea and made him into a superhero. We made him into the franchise, and we did all sorts of different things. And we did had a Big Ten football media day. We made lunch boxes. We created comic books. We had three separate series of videos. On the men's basketball side, we did our starting point guard, Brian McIntosh. He became our program's all-time assist leader. Well, it also happened to be a election year, and the Big Ten was holding the tournament out in Washington, D.C. along with Media Day. So we campaigned to have our starting point guard be the new face of the dime, right? And we created fake dimes. We had campaign t-shirts, bumper stickers, a whole social digital campaign with graphics and campaign ad videos and stuff. And we ran it right before Big Ten Media Day. And the numbers on, and we also sent all that, we sent little packages out to media members that we knew were going there and that followed college basketball. You know, the return on numbers, maybe for like some of those videos and engagement on you know, Twitter and retweets and likes and that, was maybe like a little disappointing. And you gotta take a step back for us to realizing we're one brand with football and men's basketball, and we were doing that during football season. It was a little stepping on each other's toes. But the reason we knew it was a success is we went out to Big Ten Media Day, and ESPN, Big Ten Network, Sports Illustrated, and Yahoo, they're all asking Brian McIntosh about this dime campaign, right? And they would mention it over the broadcast on games. So for us, I took that as a win, right? So the number, from a numbers perspective, I was, you know,